1.5 hour of car. First car workshop ever. I have no fixed things to do here, so I'm glad for any questions. Also, just in between stuff, I'll also take questions from Twitter and Twitch. And so to get started with car, there are lots of different options. When you go to the website, car.tech, there's a big and easy get started link. And one of the options you have is to install it from Hexlib. It's kind of the getting into it option. The Hexlib version is updated every few months. But most people actually work directly from the Git version. And Hexlib is the usual stuff. Hexlib install car. And when that's installed, you can run car's build tool, carmake, using Hexlib. It's doing Hexlib, run car, and then whatever parameters you need. But what we will do today, we'll use CodeStudio, car's own IDE. And because we are adventurous at this conference, we won't use the last release version, but we'll instead use a newer version on GitHub. If you go to GitHub, no, not Git, github.com/ktx-software, you will find repositories for each of the three big operating systems with the binaries for CodeStudio. There's CodeStudio Win32, there's CodeStudio Linux 64, also Linux 32, and there's CodeStudio.app for the OS X version. You can directly clone those repositories to get a almost up-to-date version of CodeStudio, which also includes car, so it comes with batteries included. And when you have downloaded, cloned that, and for Windows, that's what you get. And you can just run CodeStudio Exe. Which looks just like Visual Studio Code, because actually it is Visual Studio Code. And you will probably not load right into a car project like I did right now, but instead you will have to create a new one. You do that by creating a new directory. It's German, my OS, sorry, but you'll figure out how to create a directory on your system. Just a plain old empty directory, and you can then open it up in CodeStudio. That's the file menu in English, and there's some open directory option in there. So I'll navigate to that empty directory and open it up in CodeStudio. Now it's all empty. CodeStudio, just like Visual Studio Code, has a so-called command palette, and you can open that up by pressing F1. Here it is. And if you just start typing away something like car, then you get all the options which have this word included, and there's currently two car commands in the command palette in CodeStudio, and the one we want right now is init car project. So that creates a completely new car project for us. And we can just go ahead and run that. This is the debug tab in CodeStudio. Let me click that, and we have the green arrow here. And we will get a beautiful black window. So, but if we look at our project a little closer, there's a car file. That's our build file. CodeStudio creates a standard build file for you. Most of the time, you don't even have to touch this. This just adds all the assets in the assets subdirectory and all the sources in the sources subdirectory. And for most projects, that will probably be just fine. But if you want to do more complicated build steps, do something to your assets, this is where you do it. Also, when you want to add your own custom shaders, you add them here. And in the source directory, two files, main.hx as a main function. Car always starts in the main function, but you don't need to extend some whatever class to get started with car, like in some other frameworks. You just start out in the main function, and then you can run car's init function. That's an asynchronous function, and when that calls the callback you provide, car is ready to get running. System init just takes an options object. You can also just pass an empty object. All those objects in the system init object are completely optional, and depending on the target, they are actually ignored. That's the first thing that confuses a lot of people, because here are width and height parameters in the standard project, and on most targets, they just get ignored. When you build for Windows, OS X, Linux, you'll get a window of that size, but on iOS, for example, there are no windows, so that's ignored. In the HTML5 target, it's also ignored because that's thought to be embedded in a web page, and you define that using a canvas element which you size yourself. And also in CodeStudio, this parameter is ignored, so you don't start depending on some fixed window size. So, but then calls new project. That's a simple class that registers two callbacks. The first one is important. That's a callback for the render loop. That will be called for every frame that is rendered, so like on every vsync. And the second callback is optional, and you can configure how that callback works. Car has a scheduler class, which is responsible for all timing in your application, and you can add time tasks that run again and again, which you typically want for a game, for your update loop. So that's this thing here. First parameter, second parameter means it starts right away at time zero. Third parameter means it's repeated every 1/16th of a second, which is the right thing to do for many games. That's why it's in the standard project, but you can use that as you want. So, and the actual update and render functions are empty. That's the reason we see a black window. When you move into the render function, this gets passed a frame buffer object. Frame buffer has some interesting properties. namely G1, G2, and G4. Those are car's different graphics APIs. Car has a bunch of different APIs, so it can target a bunch of different systems effectively and efficiently. G1 is an API just for setting pixels directly. Set pixel x epsilon color value. That is something that will always work on all targets, because I have no plans to port car to targets which don't support a pixel-based color output currently. Somebody has a Vectrex at home, which has a vector monitor. That with that one it wouldn't work, but most other hardware supports that in some way. G2 is a more complex 2D API, has functions like draw image, draw rect, draw line. And G2 exists because it can map directly to things like HTML5 canvas, the Java Painter API, WPF in C#. It's a nice little API for doing 2D graphics and 2D games. And there's a very efficient implementation of G2 running on 3D hardware included. So it always runs fast, and on systems which can't do hardware accelerated 3D graphics, like older web browsers, it maps very nicely to older 2D APIs, which are then usually provided. And G4 is a 3D API. It's a relatively modern API, completely shader-based. While it's not Vulkan-style modern, all your synchronizations of your vertex buffers, index buffers, textures, and so on is done automatically. So it's most similar to something like OpenGL ES3. Yeah, and typically you choose one of those APIs and get started. We will get started with G2. Typically I assign that to var g is G2. And to get anything working with the graphics APIs, you have to call the begin function and the end method as well. Between those calls, you can call the actual graphics calls. The begin and end calls are important because you can actually mix car's different graphics APIs freely. You can do some 3D graphics with G4, then call end, then call begin on G2 and put some 2D graphics on top. You can also put some 2D graphics in the texture and then bind that in G4. And you can do all the mixing you might want to do. And the begin and end calls are the little magic sauce that makes that possible, so don't forget them. So we can set a color. Code completion, by the way, is provided by Hex33 and the new VS Hex plugin from this guy. And this guy works nicely so far. Let's fill a rect. And we start it, and maybe it will work. Ah, a rectangle, and it's red. Perfect. Like magic. Yeah, and that's how you do all your 2D graphics. You have draw image, and draw this, and draw that. It's a very small API, really, and you can get into that quickly, I think. There's also transformations you can apply. like which takes a 3x3 matrix, so you can do rotation, scale, and so on. You can set opacity values, but it's really a small, very small API. And maybe we can go to definition. Go to definition and have a look at it. I think you can get a pretty good understanding by just having a look at the functions available, because there aren't that many. And the real power of G2 is not in the complexity of its interface, it's in the speed of its implementation. So you can, as we have seen yesterday, you can just do plain draw image calls, and that will be very fast, even if you have lots of bunnies. Yeah, and if we want to move things on our canvas, we usually do that in some fixed time step update method. That's mostly a good idea to do it that way in games, because it will work the same on all systems independent of the actual frame rate of your monitor. So we can add some X value. Increment that in our update method and put that in here. Not all that complicated, but it's a different thing from Flash, what a lot of Hex users are used to. There is no scene graph included. It's just a plain render loop and some draw calls. So your all your object hierarchies, GUI hierarchies, you have to do all of that yourself, or use a library which runs on top of Car. But Car itself is just this low level layer that just cares about making your software run on every platform very efficiently. It's not about helping you out with all your problems. That's your mother's job. Okay. There's nowadays quite a bunch of nice tutorials for Car. If you go to GitHub, KDX software, Car, or maybe we also have a link here. Ah, tutorials. That links to the wiki on GitHub. And there's all kinds of stuff, a tutorial to make a little shoot 'em up. In 10 parts. It's a pretty nice and big one, explains everything nicely. There's another tutorial by Triple Fox. He's called James. So if you want to get further into 2D graphics with Car, those two tutorials are a very good way to start with that. And there's also Lewis Lepton's YouTube video series, which is also linked here. He's now at 20 videos or something. No, almost at 30 already. Also, it's mostly about 2D graphics and currently about the CUI API by Lubos, which is an immediate way mode GUI library. So when you want to do 2D graphics, there's lots of stuff around. Yep. Relatively lots of stuff for not such a famous library. Yeah. as of yet. And I think that became pretty easy to get into 2D graphics with CAR. So let's do some 3D graphics and shaders instead. There's a super simple getting started project for that. Generally speaking, in the KTX software GitHub, there's lots of stuff for some reasons, but there are also some small samples for CAR hidden, which I still have to make a list of. And there's also this tiny little shader sample. That's not for CAR, that's for Core, but for CAR it's just called shader. This is the smallest possible program to get started with G4 in CAR and with your own shaders. You can have a look at that to get started, but I guess I'll try to do that myself and fall back to the sample if I fail. So we use G4 instead of G2. And using G4 needs a lot more background info. You have to have some understanding of 3D graphics. But at least in my opinion, it's much easier to get started with G4 than with Direct3D or OpenGL. It's a streamlined API that doesn't have old stuff lying around like all the other APIs. And it has only two different draw calls, actually. You can only draw triangles, no rectangles, no lines. Reason for that is that most hardware, at least as far as I know nowadays, also only renders triangles. So when you draw rectangles with OpenGL, your driver will actually split that into triangles. And it's also trivial to do that yourself, and you keep a better overview of what's actually happening on your hardware. So only triangles. And that draw call for triangles is called draw indexed vertices. Takes two optional parameters. But if we just call that, nothing at all will happen because we need always a vertex buffer and an index buffer. The vertex buffer includes our triangle edge positions, and the index buffer contains indices into that vertex buffer and always takes 3 points out of there to form a triangle. So let's create some buffers. We create the easiest possible index buffer. New. We want a new one. That takes an index count. That's quite logical, I think. We take 3 indices, we will draw 1 big old triangle, and it takes a usage parameter. That's 4, usage. The usage parameter, there are similar things in OpenGL, is a hint for CAR and for the graphics driver eventually of how this buffer will be used. Static usage means you will upload that to your GPU once and never change it. That's static. Dynamic usage means that buffer will probably be changed, so maybe don't upload it to graphics memory and keep it in your CPU accessible memory. Readable, of course, means you want to read that not only from your GPU, which will always happen with an index buffer, but also from your CPU. So if you can have an actual static usage in mind for your buffer, do that, and it will be faster. So to get actual data into the buffer, you log it. And that will return an array. And you can just set some values in there. And this, as I have said, will be the most complicated index buffer ever. Takes a 0, a 1, and a 2. When you're done putting data inside, you unlock your buffer, not unshift. Oh, not that one, this one. Oh my, thank you. But let's see, when I just save it, it should show me the, somebody failed. Okay. Now we need our vertex buffer. That's a little bit more complicated because you have to understand the coordinate system that's used here. Like in all other 3D APIs, coordinates on X and Y go from -1 to +1. And like in OpenGL, Z coordinates also go from -1 to +1. In Direct3D, Z coordinates are from 0 to +1, I think, which is a little bit better for set buffer precision. So that might actually be changed in CAR in the future to work like Direct3D. But that's always a little tricky when going from OpenGL and Direct3D and other 3D APIs because the fundamental coordinate systems are different. CAR fixes that by automatically patching your shaders to use just one coordinate system, and currently that's -1, -1, -1, -1. So we create our vertex buffer. We buffer. Vertex buffer. Here, it's just more complicated. We want 3 vertices, that's not so hard, but it wants some structure thing. We will create that later. And usage, that's just the same thing. Static usage. So what about the structure? The structure defines the connection from your CPU code to your shaders, because the vertex buffer is basically then passed to the vertex shader, and the vertex shader takes a bunch of data, and how that data is structured, that's what you define in your vertex structure object. So let's create that. Takes nothing, but you can add something, and whatever you have, add, has a name and a data type. Those data types are the typical data types you use in your shaders to get data from a vertex buffer, yes?
Use them for vertex, for
No. It's just floats, yeah. And your GPU will typically want to use floats to do all its work. Older GPUs actually only support floats internally, and when you do integer math, say the compiler will transform that to to floats and do some approximate integer mathematics. And so the parameters for your vertex buffer are just floats in car. I'm not actually sure you can pass in integers on all supported backends. So that's something I would have to look up before I can add that, but it's can be useful. So, yeah, exactly, yeah. Yeah, exactly, and that's important, yeah. Yeah, completely right. So, open an issue on GitHub and I'll see what I can do. So, but what we did here is we told the vertex buffer that it has one input parameter, which is called pose, and this is float 3. So, now let's lock our vertex buffer. And copy in our data from that sample, because I'm lazy. So, looks like this. Okay, now we filled all the data we pump into the GPU to get it to display a simple triangle. But that's still not enough, because nowadays shaders do nothing before you upload a program to them, which then runs on the data you provided. Those are the so-called shaders, so we can't do much here without creating some small shaders. So let's create a new directory in our project, call it shaders, and add a line to our car file, which I should maybe in the future add by default when a new project is created. But you can do add shaders. And that's now in sources, shaders. Little difference here between those three lines. The add assets and add shaders functions take stars as placeholders for two stars means everything below this directory, including subdirectories. One star means everything inside this directory. No stars when you add your hex sources, because that's how hex works. You just put in a directory and it takes that kind of like Java, not so much like C. So that explains the difference here, why that has those have the stars and this one doesn't have it. But now let's create some shaders. New file, right? Yeah. We create one which we will call shader.word.glsl and another one shader.frag.glsl. So, when you run modern graphics, you usually provide two different shaders. One which is called on every vertex of every triangle, and one, which is in the next step then called on every pixel. That's usually called the fragment shader, and the other one, the vertex shader. Fragment shader is something sometimes also called pixel shader, depending on if you're talking to some OpenGL guy or some Microsoft guy. And shaders have main functions, just like your regular source code. And there are some special variables which you can write to, which provides a connection from the vertex shader to the fragment shader and from the fragment shader to the pixels on the screen. For the fragment shader, there's one special parameter which you have to write to, which is called GL position. And whatever you write there, write to that variable, will be the actual position on your screen in this -1 to 1 coordinate system. And that's what the vertex shader is for. It transforms your vertices to whatever you need. And typically, one parameter of your vertex shader you set is some matrix, which is responsible for the transformation. But for our simple example, we will just pass through our pause parameter. And to get that in, we write attribute. We use the float 3, that's then a vec 3 in GLSL, and it's called pause. It's important that this name is the same name you provided in your vertex structure. The extension of the file? Shader.word.glsl. GLSL. And GL position is a vec 4, so we convert that. This should work. So that's a simple pass through vertex shader that takes the position we provided in the vertex buffer and just uses that as the actual position to render triangle. So let's see if the shader in the sample looks like that. Very much. We didn't provide set coordinate. Maybe we should change that. No, it's fine. All fine. And what was the name? Gale frag color. It was Gale frag color in the fragment shader. So, void main again. GL frag color, I think. Yeah, looking good. That's a special variable in the fragment shader. And whatever you put in here will be your output pixel color. So we put in vec 4. And this will be solid red. Let's see what that's the same thing to. Yeah, looks quite similar. So that might actually work out. So we now have our shaders in our project, but we still have to bind those shaders to our project. I make it a little, is that still okay? Maybe. So, to get anything on screen in car, you have to create a so-called pipeline state object. That is not how it works in OpenGL. That is actually how it works in Vulkan and D3D12. So, pipeline is new, prefix 4, pipeline state. And the pipeline has a bunch of stuff you can set. A lot of stuff, actually. All your blending operations are set in the pipeline. Your depth compare mode and also your different shader types. All those values have default values, which in most situations will make sense. But what you always have to set is the input layout, which is an array of structures, because you can actually put multiple vertex buffers in, which is important if you do instance rendering. And you have to set your vertex shader. And that's probably not in here yet. Well, it was called shader word, fragment shader, car shaders dot shader frag. So the now we get our error handling. The shaders you provide in your project, in your car project, are made available, at least the names, directly in your project, and you can use code completion in Code Studio and also in Hex development to see what shaders are available. We get an error here because we didn't build our project for a while. But one other thing first, when you are done setting all the data in your pipeline, you compile it, and then you don't change it anymore. And that's the thing that was introduced in all those brand new graphics APIs. Because traditionally, when you use OpenGL or D3D, you set your shaders, but you also set a huge bunch of different render states. Like, how does your depth buffer compare depth values? How does that work? There's state you can set. Is it rendered when the previous depth value is smaller or when it's bigger? And blending is on most hardware not programmable. So all the things you do with transparency are also just a bunch of states you set in your API. And OpenGL has a lot of functions for that, like set blender state, blah, 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 set depth mode, blah, 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 set stencil mode, blah, blah, blah. And the problem with that approach is that those different modes do not necessarily map to what is a mode on your actual hardware. Some hardware might actually have kind of switches like that. Some other hardware, for some other hardware that might actually be part of the native shaders. But that means setting your shaders and then setting some random modes in OpenGL can randomly trigger shader recompiles in the driver, which will result in some stuttering in your game or whatever you're programming. That's a big reason why in Vulkan there are no state setting functions, but instead one giant big pipeline state object, and you compile that once and don't change that. And when you want to have different variations, like you want to use the same shaders with different blending modes, you create multiple pipeline objects, compile them, keep them around, and then just switch between them, which is then mostly guaranteed to be fast, because you explicitly tell the driver to compile all that stuff in one block, and then you just switch. So it's just to get a little closer to how the hardware actually works. So if we now launch it, it will not yet work because we don't have our vertex buffer and pipeline and so on set yet, but I want to compile it once because, yeah, it will stay black. But now the errors are gone. That is because when you launch the game in Code Studio, it runs CarMake, Cars Build Tool, which not only compiles hex code, which is not the problem here, the VSHex plugin understands hex code, it uses the HXML file that was created by CarMake. There's rarely a reason to change that file, but when shaders or assets are changed, VSHex doesn't immediately recognize that because the files which are read in by the macros are not changing by themselves. So you run it once, which calls CarMake, which compiles all your shaders and creates the files which are then read in by the macros. And then you have code completion for all the files you have added. And here are our two little shaders. Works also for images and so on. So now we have that sorted out, and now we just have to remember all our stuff here, because we just created it and then ignore it, which won't help us. So let's remember the index buffer, the structure. We can then forget about the structure, but we need this one. Everything all right? Everything looking good? Hopefully. So, now that we have them, we can do g.set index buffer, ebuffer, g.set vertex buffer, vbuffer, g.set pipeline, pipeline. And if we are really lucky, this will now work. Most of the time when you do stuff like that, it won't just work. That's why I did this shader debugging thing, but that's not yet in the official release of Code Studio. So we have to just hope it works out. Ah. Beautiful, right? And that's the basis for all 3D graphics in car. That's how you do it. To do more with that, you write bigger shaders with more parameters, create bigger vertex buffers, and so on. But that's all the basics of 3D graphics in car. If you want to see more of that, there's a a 3D tutorial by Lubos, which starts out just like what we did with a triangle, or it's a different triangle, it's also red. But he then goes on and describes how you do perspective projection with a matrix and said that. Only on weekdays. Yeah, colored cubes even. So if you want to get further into it, that's the tutorial to read. Textures and so on, but it's not so much more compared to what we have seen today. It's always like that with the 3D APIs, even more so with the super modern APIs. Getting a triangle on the screen is kind of the hardest thing. You have to understand index buffers, vertex buffers, shaders, how all the data flows into and out of that, and then you can finally get a triangle on your screen. But based on that, you can relatively easily do all the other more fancy stuff. And that's actually all I wanted to show you today. I can maybe there are questions, or if not, I would go into the car source code and explain a little bit how stuff works internally. Yeah? Yeah, yeah, yeah. I reserved.
That might be related. Is like, is that going to be a sort of like an abstraction layer of the G4? Is that maybe what it's for? Like where you can.
G3 is reserved for older 3D hardware, pre-shader 3D hardware, like OpenGL1. That's what I eventually want to do to support older systems. And when I do that, there will, of course, be a G3 implementation based on G4. So you will have a little easier way of doing 3D graphics. But the main difference really between old OpenGL and old 3D graphics in general is there are no shaders, which means it looks very much like that, but this part is just missing, and instead you set even more render state. Yeah. It's not that much easier, so it's more about supporting all the hardware. Yeah. And yeah, there are no plans to put something in car directly to make graphics easier than that, because all what G4 really is, it's on the level of OpenGL, D3D, Metal. It just tries to provide exactly same functionality in a more logical, streamlined way, but no fundamental differences. There's of course Lubos huge 3D engine in development, which will hopefully come out sometime. And there's a bunch of guys trying 3D things with car and doing some interesting things, but as far as I know, no thing like an easy to use 3D engine on top of car yet that's actually available. Yeah. But I hope that will happen someday, because car itself, it just wants to be this bottom layer of your game or graphics engine, because that's people put so much time into making stuff run on different systems, especially if they also have to target consoles, and so many people fail with that. And I want to make it possible for them to just concentrate on the interesting stuff. I do the stupid stuff so other people can do the interesting stuff. Because getting that to work on all systems is a lot of really stupid work, really. You have to take care of all those little, completely pointless differences between different systems. like in D3D9, the way pixels work is different than in other 3D APIs. They use half pixel positions and it's kind of messy, so I patch the shaders so it works the same again on our systems, and lots of those little things that nobody really wants to have anything to do with. That's what CAR does. The G5 API? That's currently just in the HTML5 target, and this is somewhere hidden here. And maybe I also check that into GitHub in the post audio branch. Let's see. Backends HTML5 that replaces the previous audio 2 API, like the graphics APIs. CAR also has two audio APIs. Audio 1 is play sound, and audio 2 is here's a bunch of loads. That's my sound stream. Put it to the hardware and notify me when you need more. That's the lowest level, basically, you can do with sound. But that's kind of a little higher level now. So you now have these audio track objects. That's what I talked about, those audio tracks you position in your room. That's supposed to be positioned using normalized values from -1 to 1, like your OpenGL coordinates. Because what the audio system in the end really needs is not the position, but just the direction relative to you. So you create an audio track. You provide a position or a speaker. You still have the option to use to put your audio on the speaker directly. And this is private, bunch of code, more bunch of code. And then you set your callback. And that callback will be called by the backend when it needs more sound for that channel. So you create a bunch of these audio track objects, register your callbacks, and then you stream audio into that. So it's still a very low level thing. So audio one will change based on that also, but I haven't figured out yet how exactly that will look like. But that's it currently. That's the stuff for the audio simulation on headphones. Needs to load in a file for the measured audio response from some guy, the so-called head-related something thing. Head-related transfer function. That's how it's called. Yeah, you init it, and somewhere is a, here are the add track and remove tracks functions. And that's it. That's the old API that's still hanging around here that will go away. It's in the branch right now. And the audio streaming to a 5.1 system is implemented here. I couldn't actually yet test it properly because it's kind of a tragedy, and I don't know how that could happen in Paris, but our hotel room doesn't have a surround audio system. Yeah, that's the state of that. It's currently in the branch and in the HTML5 backend because the headphone simulation used some web audio functionality, which I then have to replicate natively to get it running everywhere. Yeah, will happen in the coming weeks. I hope in 2 weeks, maybe not next week, I won't have much time. It's another conference in Darmstadt. Yeah, that's the audio situation. then let's look a little into how car works. Yeah.
The outline value of USG4 and G2 together?
Ah, yes. That's pretty easy. So, G2.begin. G2.color. Now we will do something completely different. Do we still have our X? Yes, we do. So we put it in. And it doesn't work, right? You know, blue stuff is really complicated.
Sorry.
Does that still? First one to try, is that still? Did I edit something? Still working? Okay, other way around. So it kind of works sometimes. We are working on the current Git version, so things do break some of the time, and some things don't work because nobody actually tested that. So maybe nobody put 3D in the back and just on the top, I don't know. But I will fix that promptly, I hope. But if something like that happens, there are GitHub issues. I'm also about 20 hours per day on the car IRC chat. So we figure it out when that happens. So things, sadly, they do happen. And they tend to actually happen a little more frequently than on other platforms because we support I don't know how many graphics backends. And little things like that slip in when you do that. And yeah, you have to work continuously to figure all that out and make all the different things work everywhere. And I hope in the future we will also get more automatic testing going with some automatic rendering and comparing screenshots so everything keeps working. And the shader debugging I showed, which is based on a software implementation of G4 and in the future, I think also G5. I hope when that grows to make that the actual reference graphics implementation and run automatic tests comparing the software rasterizer to the hardware rasterizer on different systems to get these things more and more stable. But that's kind of the long-term task for car, for me in car, to get all those little bugs figured out. It's becoming more and more rare already that things like that don't work. But you know, I do my best. Okay. Yeah, have you seen Luba's video about that? Yeah, he made a video about it. How do we find that? Let's look for Luba's. some video. That's running in car also. No, that one isn't. That's just Blender. This is running in car. That's a video texture right there. And, but the one I was talking about, this one. Yeah, this has just cars Tetris sample assigned to a texture. So this, all that stuff does work. Yeah, it's all that's kind of dangerous, showing stuff live on a recent Git release. But it will work better and better and more reliable and more reliable. So, but now to what I wanted to talk about, wanted to show you a bit how car is, how it works internally, what's in there, around there. When you look into the car directory, that's how it looks. There's some boring files you don't need to care about. And there's the sources folder. You probably guessed it, that's the actual source code of car. The platform independent part of the source code, which also includes the shaders, which are used to implement G2 on hardware, which actually supports the G4 target. That's the stuff that makes bunny runs fast. But there's also this backends directory. That's the code for the different targets, and there's quite a bunch of them. They use different target languages from Hex. That's the Android Java target, HTML5 target, Flash, empty target is totally exciting. I built that in to generate the documentation. There's the mysterious CoreHL target. Can't talk about that, I guess. There's a node target, which compiles a car application to a headless server mode application. So you can run your car application on a Node.js server and then open a network connection. That's for multiplayer games. That node, the node backend actually has an implementation of G4, which does nothing. And Unity is the more fancy stuff. But the most important backend is the core backend. As you hopefully remember from yesterday, core is car's C++ sister project. That itself has a bunch of backends for all the different systems you can target with C or C++. And car has just one core backend, which targets core, which then targets all the other systems. So it's kind of using SDL to target different native systems, but it's my own SDL competitor. So, and right in the top folder of car, there's the core folder, and when you go into that, it looks very similar to the car folder, because it is very similar in structure to car. There's also sources and there's backends, and those are all the different native backends, and there are some complete system backends, and some backends are just for graphics. Because on Windows you can use D3D9, 11 or 12. You can also use OpenGL on Windows if you want that. The famous Vulkan backend. It's a pretty big one. Want to see some Vulkan code? Vulkan is actually, it's a lot less complicated than it looks on the first look. There's a gigantic amount of initialization code for Vulkan to work, but you kind of copy that and restructure it, and then it kind of works. But all the smaller things, Car and Core, by the way, are also a great tool to learn how all these different native APIs work, because Car has a pretty streamlined API, and you can just go into that and see how all of that is mapped to the actual native APIs. So if we go to the vertex buffer, IMPL for Vulkan, we can see how that stuff actually works for Vulkan. And it's not that complicated. In Vulkan, you will always see a lot of struct initialization, because Vulkan, for the most part, takes structs as parameters to make things more extensible. Downside to this is it makes even simple things very large code blocks. But you can, yeah, Core is kind of the perfect introduction to Vulkan and all the other graphics APIs, because it's structured nicely in all the different things you really need to do in those APIs, and you can see how to do it in there. Yeah, and that's how that works. Core and Car both have their own build systems, CarMake and CoreMake respectively, and they don't build stuff themselves. Instead, they create project files for the different IDEs or build tools that are used for the different target systems. So for example, if you, let's go to the regular Tetris sample. Currently in CodeStudio, that's an important point, you can only develop your applications, but there are not yet any options in CodeStudio to actually export your projects to any actual target system. You just build for Car's debugger inside of CodeStudio. The actual compilation for target systems you still have to do from the command line, and that works like that. You call CarMake. If you use the Git version of Car, you call it like that. It's a node-based tool. So you say node and point it to the make.js file inside of Car. And if you use the hexlib version, you do instead hexlib car. This is the exact same thing. So what here we do node CarMake. Windows will convert your assets, will create, will convert your shaders, will compile your hex code, and will then create a project for Visual Studio. And that all ends up in the build subdirectory, and there are subdirectory for all the different systems you build stuff for. So you go to the Windows build directory, and you can open up your Visual Studio project. You can also just add a compile parameter, and then CarMake calls CoreMake, which then will actually call a Visual Studio command, which compiles a Visual Studio project. So you don't have to move into Visual Studio to create Windows native projects, but it's really nice for debugging and profiling, because you have all your source right here and can see what's going on. In the code style file, nothing goes on, and the error is of course never called, but here some stuff goes on. Yeah, and you can set breakpoints and everything, and when I create new native targets, I develop them directly in the corresponding IDEs, and that's very convenient. And I can do things like call all of Visual Studio's tools, and there's a lot of tools out there which plug right into Visual Studio, like Intel's Profiler, which I mentioned in my talk. That is a standalone tool, but it's also a Visual Studio plugin. And you have that installed. You have some additional fancy icons on top here. You can just click that, and Intel VTune will know everything it needs to know about your project, because it's just a completely regular Visual Studio project. So that's how that works. So 10 minutes left for questions. Twitter, nothing interesting. Won't look at private messages because maybe it's something actually private. Who knows?
Could you show the example how can I store in assets in runtime? Is it possible? For example, I load image from the web and store it in assets.
Not possible.
Not possible.
Everything is possible, but no functionality in there to do that.
Okay. Yeah.
There's actually a long GitHub issue where people try to do that, and I really have to look that up and help them out. It's when you compile for HTML5, it will by default pull the assets from the URLs. Yeah, and the asset handling, if you use the default functionality, it's abstracted for you because it works differently on all those different systems. Your JavaScript application will want to load that from the web server, and your local application will load that from your file system, which also makes it possible to, that's not done yet, but I hope to do it soon, to implement some file packaging so you can just distribute two files which have everything in there, and because the file mention is abstracted, I can do things like that. There's also an API to load files manually, load images manually, but currently there's no way to differentiate between loading from the file system and loading from the web in that API. And when you target HTML5, it will always try to load from the web, and if you target something else, it will always try to load from the file system. So that's the thing that hopefully I will extend someday. So there isn't the manual assets API, just doesn't have that feature yet.
I had another question regarding Chrome.
Chrome.
What's exactly in there? How much did you take out? Would it be possible to have an application where you say the UI were made in HTML?
If no,
you find that
no.
Convenient or
Chrome is just V8 and Core. There's no HTML, no CSS, nothing of that. Just the fast stuff is in there. The slow stuff is out.
Okay.
Yeah.
So the V8.
But you can use Electron for that.
And is Node in there or something?
No.
Nothing.
No Node.
So no file system access, no nothing.
Yeah, file system access, I want to. Yeah, as I said, currently file system access is kind of abstracted. And if you load a file with Chrome, it will load it from the local file system.
Okay.
But there's no API like move files around, copy files, rename files. That's not in there.
Oh, I was wondering like the things that were already bundled in Chrome. I mean,
it's just V8 plus Core and exposes a bunch of functions for Core.
Okay.
And just exposes the functions from Core which are needed for car to run, which is kind of all of them because car and Core are very closely related.
Okay. And another question generally, text rendering, is that?
Yeah, it's in there.
An important issue in car or?
Yeah, kind of, but text rendering is hard. Currently, what's happening with text rendering in car, there's a port of STB TrueType in there that might actually be interesting for other frameworks to take and use. It's a full port of the C code to hex. So it renders it at runtime, it can transform TTF files to bitmap fonts. That's what it does. So you can adjust the bitmap sizes at runtime to your display size, something like that. That's possible. Right. Yeah, but the actual rendering of the fonts is not as good as font rendering in Windows itself or even the Flash player. Yeah. There's no subpixel anti-aliasing. Yeah, it's not super high-end text rendering in car.
That's okay. My eyes are getting worse anyway, so I won't see it.
Use big fonts. That's usually, and luckily displays nowadays get higher density pixels, so the hardware manufacturers do work for me.
Great, thanks.
Okay. What kind of optimization do you mean?
As far as
from the hex side of things, the vertex buffers are nicely optimated. The index buffers not so much. The index buffer currently returns just a plain old hex array, which is not the fastest thing. The vertex buffer lock function returns a custom array implementation thing. That actually, when you compile to native, your hex code will work with just the pointer, which was returned by the graphics API beneath that.
Writing only, blocking only one buffer at a time. For example, for Flash,
no. As far as I know, there are no limitations like that. But maybe there is something on some target I don't know about yet. But normally it should work to lock multiple buffers and close them when you want to.
It's just a way to write in memory in Flash, and you can use, for example, 32-bit ports instead of 64.
Yeah, can you even do that in Flash? Can you even do that in Flash?
You're not creating.
You're talking about this low-level memory API in Flash you're talking about. I read about that 10 years ago. I never used it myself, so no. But interesting thing to try.
But
yeah.
This will currently make limitations on my other mode. It won't allow you to write into several buffers that I
have. I understand. Yeah, don't know about that yet. But yeah, interesting. Yeah, this. I remember the discussions about that years ago when you could make Flash run faster based on that APA. And then there was a story when Adobe wanted to get money for using that API. That was the most stupid thing ever. Okay, I remember now. So I'll have a quick look at the questions here in Twitch if I can maybe. Yeah, English is okay. Oh, they looked like they were talking before I opened the tab. Shouldn't clear color? I think they are talking to about something else. Can you talk about galleries and sprite sheets? Ah, that's what Justin talked about in the chat before, so I kind of know what he means. Asked about the shader debug or more from Chrome stuff. We talked about Chrome. Shader debugging, it's currently in a very early stage. So it supports red triangles. I'm working on support for blue triangles. All the basics are there. It cross-compiles shaders, and there's a software rasterizer, which is really designed to work like the hardware in modern GPUs. So you get the actual same outputs from that. But both of that is very early. Currently, it will break if you use more complicated shaders. But I hope to get it in the nicely usable state during the next month, because it's nice work, actually, to implement the software rasterizer, let it do more fancy stuff. And it's also surprisingly easy work, because it happens on the CPU. You can see what happens. It's really so much easier. Yeah. So it's actually, I started implementing that just last week, and it progressed pretty quickly, so I think that will be in a usable state very soon. Okay, galleries and sprite sheets. Sprite sheets are kind of trivial with car when you use G2. There's a draw sub-image method which you can use to use sprite sheets, and sprite sheets are in car a good optimization for performance because it avoids buffer flushes in the G4 based G2 implementation. Yeah. That's a good optimization currently on most 2D graphics frameworks, things like that. In the future, I hope that won't be possible anymore, because there's now features like texture arrays and bindless textures, which I still have to use in my G2 implementation to make that less of an issue. But currently, a texture atlas is still a very good idea. And what Justin wants to know, he was talking in the chat earlier about implementing a huge image gallery, which may be more images than can fit into memory, or one gigantic image that maybe doesn't fit into memory. That kind of borders the things that id Software did with Rage, with their mega textures and stuff. There's nothing for that in car currently, but newer graphics APIs actually expose functionality for that. You can have textures of big sizes where not every part of the texture is loaded in at the same time. So that's an interesting thing to explore, but currently using more images than you have space in your memory is a problem, like everywhere. Huh? Okay. Any more questions? Then we're done for today, and I go home.